less unsuccessful. Okay, so the theme is Masonry structures, and tonight we'll see something about Masonry structures in a different context. And there is a very simple model for Masonry materials. It is a unilateral model. That is, the material is very brittle. The Masonry material is brittle, and the toughness is very random. So it's a good idea to assume that the material is unilateral. And this idea was first introduced by Hyman in his pioneeristic work in 67. This is a number that you see here, a reference that you'll see in a moment. And then in Italy in the 80s, there were some people working on this subject, and they introduced the assumption of elasticity in compression, and they put some assumptions on the inelastic part, that is the deformations that you have to consider when you put a unilateral constraint. If you put a constraint on stress, you have a part that is non-constitutive, that is the fracture. And you see the name of Gian Pietro here. This is a very nice paper that anyone that wants to learn something about this topic should read. Also, there is a name that is important, Di Pasquale. And you see also some names of Giaquinto e Giusti, that are two mathematicians. I've seen here here there is a melting of physicists, mathematicians, and engineers. I am an engineer, actually. I used to be an architect. But I think that this melting is very important. And now there is an idea that engineering has to go a different way, but I think that is a stupid idea. Okay. What I'll show you, if I can, is that these theories can be put to some use also in very practical things. Okay. These are the references. The first five are references on the unilateral. The first one is the work of Hyman, is the book, is not the paper. The paper was in 67. Then there is a book that is longer. Then there is the work by Di Pasquale. That actually is the first one from which I heard about unilateral materials. And then there is this mathematical paper by Giaquinto e Giusti that proved the existence of solution under some conditions for the boundary value problem of this NENT, that means normal elastic notation material. And the two in red are the works of Del Piero that I will refer to over and over. The last maybe we'll need later. Okay. In the practical applications, there are three models, basically, that one can use. And actually, the behavior of Masonry is very complicated. And you can use very fancy model. But in the real structure, all the structures, it's very difficult to know what the parameters are, and it's very difficult to use fancy models. So you have to use very primitive models. And I call these three models that I will use, and I will show some applications of these three models. Are model 0, 1, and 2. And these names are the number of parameters that are needed to identify them. I mean, the model 0, 0 parameters, so on. The order in which I put the models is an order of improvement. And is not the order, the application you see is not the order of the more recent are the last. So you see the more recent at the beginning that are concerned with the zero model. What are these models? It's very simple. I was told to talk to students. So I was prepared to write on the blackboard, but then I didn't want to compete with the with Gian Pietro. It's impossible, it's too precise and too rigorous. I will do a mess, so I prefer to make an overview. And okay. Yes. So what are these models? The models are here. Model 0 is just rigid, unilateral. This is how a test on Mesory looks like. Mesory is a very wide word. I mean, the Mesory can be anything. It can be stones or tuff or just stone one on top of the other. So it depends on that, of course. But this aspect you see over and over in the application. So the first one is this one. What I say here? Yes, the material is rigid in compression, but it's elastic in traction. Elastic. So it means that it can go. Okay. So this is model one. That is this one. It's a model in which you add an assumption of elasticity in compression, a linear elastic behavior. And then here there is a fracture part, but there is also an elastic part that is compression. So you can have either elongation and shortening. And here there is also a stored energy function. The material is actually hyperelastic. This model requires one parameter, at least in 1D. And then you can add an assumption of limit strength in compression just to model the crushing of the material. Because there are many examples in the real world in which the material is not much stressed, like in this structure which we see here. The mean stresses are very low compared to the strength of the material. But there are other applications in which it comes into play, the strength of the material. And here it's, the assumption is made that the material is elastic plastic. Of course, in real application, you have to put a limit on the amount of plastic strain that you can accumulate in compression. Okay. Here I have a lot of slides, but I have put the alarm clock. So when after 35 minutes you will ring, it's not anybody that's calling me, just the alarm clock. Okay, so this is the energy. And you see the energy just draw it in the case of the elastic non-tensile material. You see that this is concave, but it's not strictly concave. It has this flat part, and this is the more interesting part for a mathematician, because there is no growth of the energy. And this, what you can get with some assumptions is a linear growth. And so you have to admit discontinuities. And here instead you see a material that is still hyperelastic. I don't know if I wrote right somewhere the name of Gianpietro, maybe later, because in the 3D case you can show that elastic notation material is hyperelastic. And that was done in the general case by Gianpietro. This is hyperelastic, but it has a threshold. And actually, this is good when you load, but not for unloading. And upon unloading, the behavior is like this. But if still you can use an energy, like Gianpietro has taught us during this course. Actually, in the applications I will show you, we use that kind of approach. I mean, we look for equilibrium solutions by minimizing an energy, also if the material is has an incremental path-dependent behavior. And Gianpietro, if I understood, he derives plasticity from an assumption of from a variational principle. So we use it because it's good in applications in numerics. Okay. Of course, you have to pass from 1D to 3D. What is the price to pay? To get elasticity, and even hyperelasticity, you have to assume you have to make a kind of a normality assumption on the anelastic strain. And this assumption is good because for the model zero, it gives you the possibility to apply the theorems of limit analysis. I mean the static and kinematic theorems. The examples I will show are just on the static theorem. And in the case of the model 1, this gives you the possibility to introduce an energy. So the material is hyperelastic. This is the work of Gian Pietro that I quoted before. And in the case of the model 2, which there is this crushing strength, I assume an associated flow rule. This is, of course, not very good, no? Because you know that the behavior of stones is with friction. So, but it's just the very simplest possible. Here there is a remark. I don't want maybe if there are questions about it, this I'll talk a little later. I mean, there are people thinking that the only model that you can use for old masonry is the model zero. And there are good reasons for that. I have a little different idea, but I think that you can use also elastic, the elastic with the Granus Alice, the elastic model. Okay, so let's go to the model zero. This is the rigid no-tension material. What is nice in all this story is that this model that is rather crude but is complicated from a mathematical point of view, there is a nice mathematics behind it, it's important for real structures. It's behind the way in which the old masons built their structures. I hope that, I think that Gian Pietro tonight will explain you why. And essentially what is the different idea is that instead of using stress requirements for safety, they use geometrical rules. There is no sign of size, okay? It's important only the geometry. And this fact, this geometrical type of strength, it is essentially due to unilaterally, to the unilateral behavior. Okay, so I said that the first thing that you can do is using the theorems of limit analysis. Of course, to use them you have to prove something, and there is this paper by Gian Pietro, which a nice paper in which this proof was made. And but remark again that maybe this idea was the fact that this theorem hold was in the mind of the old architects. They knew that in some way, also if they couldn't express that in a rational way, because it was before the mechanics was developed. What is the theorem of limit analysis that I will use is the static theorem that essentially says that you can find a stress state that is balanced with the loads and is it respects the constraint of being unilateral. This is an absolute proof that the structure will not collapse. So this is the way in which the theorem can be used. Then there is another that uses kinematics. I won't show you anything about that today. Okay, this is just philosophy. Actually, what is strange is that the first model that I proposed for masonry is not elastic, the linear elastic. For all solids, we are used to the fact that the first model is the linear elastic, but this is not very good for masonry. And this is because at the levels of stress that are low, in which the material works, you already see fractures. Fractures are kind of physiological in masonry, so you have to have a model in which there are such fractures concentrated as merit. Okay, there is this question. How were arches and buttresses designed in the past? Because there was no tools, okay? There were these rules, and we know that these rules there are. I'm not an historian, so I read some books, and some of these rules are survived. And one of these rules is the rule, the Durand's rule. okay, let's just skip that. The tool that I will use to create these stress fields that are safe is using essentially singular stress fields, because it is possible to have stress fields that concentrate on lines. I just talk about the rules of proportion that I already said, for especially for vaulted structure and arches. Here is the reference to the Rand's rule that I will show you in a moment. And this is the kind of stress discontinuities and singular stress that you will see. This is stress discontinuities are kind of usual, but now you can have also singularities. I consider just the possibilities in the 2D case to have a Dirac delta, a line Dirac delta on a line that can be seen as a bar or an arch on which there is a concentrated normal axial force, and this force take the imbalance of the stress across, because in this case the stress emerging, the traction emerging on the line must be continuous. In the case you admit singularities in equilibrium, the stress can have a jump, and this jump is compensated by the singular stress, that is the normal, the axial force. In the 3D case, instead of a line, you can have a surface. On this surface, you can have a surface Dirac delta, so you have a membrane that must be inside the body because of the unilateral constraints on stress. Okay. Here there is just an analytic tool that is well known, that is the Airy stress function. For people that is not familiar with it, I will say that it's a kind of potential in terms of which you can solve the equilibrium equations when B is zero. So you have to transform the data on the boundary in such a way on F. This is the way in which it's done. The value of F is the moment of the loads on a structure one-dimensional that has the form of the boundary, and the normal derivative is the axial force. Okay, this go ahead, because regularity, I don't want to think about that, because we have experts here and want to be killed. Okay. The unilateral restrictions on stress, that is that there is no traction, transform on F on the fact that this must be concave. So you can choose, for equilibrium you have to choose a surface that meets the data on the boundary, the value and the normal slope of the boundary, but it must be concave. So this is a simple way to create a safe state. And this is not that important for two-dimensional problems. So tomorrow you'll see something by Massimiliano Lucchesi that does something similar. And in the 2D, I am more interested in what happens with the 3D applications, I mean with the vaults and membranes. This is a very stupid case. There are two forces on a strip. This is are the data on the boundary. This is the value of F. This is the value of the normal derivative. And so this is what you see. You have to create a surface there, and if you can create a surface that has a jump in the slope, a roof. And the jump there, you take the derivatives, the second derivative is the Dirac delta, that is the stress, the axial stress, that is balanced. And so here you have a kind of bar that carries the load. Okay. This is another very simple primitive example, that is the racking of a wall under an horizontal force. And here is shown how you can produce the solution. That is it's not the only way, but sometimes this kind of construction can help to construct with respect to other methods. So this is the data on the boundary. You propagate this data with the ruled surface. Where they meet, you create the structure, that is this one. And then you get the statically admissible stress, and this is the proof that is at least is not a collapse load. This is a case of limit load, because here you have not only a statical admissible stress, but also a mechanism for which the loads do not work. Okay. This is another way to obtain directly the shape of the arch. This is a panel under its unweight. There is an horizontal force. The idea is that there is a uniaxial stress, vertical uniaxial stress. There is a jump across this line. You look for this line. So there is a very simple equation that you can solve. And you find this is another example in which also there is also a distributed force on top. And this is another one that can be of some interest for structures like this, you know? This, what is the name? Portal. Huh? A sequence of arches, one. And if you look at this solution, you understand why they are so good in earthquakes. They are very good with horizontal forces. Very good. Of course, you have to assume that there is infinite strength in compression, but the stress is very low. Okay? So this is not very far from reality. Okay, this is the Verant's rule that I was talking about. It was a very simple rule, and it was good both for shallow arches and pointed arches. And what the rule is shown here. You have to take the arch, divide it into three parts, and that projection gives you the width of the pier. Okay, so it's shown somehow, I don't know if you see this picture here. These are real things, where you see exactly that value, okay? And there are works by Huerta and other people in Spain that made this kind of search of this of what was done, and actually this rule was applied quite diffusely, okay? And so this is what the rule gives. This alpha is how the arch is shallow or pointed, okay? So if you go this way, it's shallow. If you go this way, it's pointed. So this kink is when you pass from the shallow to the pointed arch, okay? This kink in the curve. And with the? Ah, here. Oh, okay. The Verant's rule is 600, the end of 600. But there is a book. But this book was collecting things that were from Middle Age. So it's and these churches are Gothic. So these rules were applied much before that this rule was written in this book. Okay. I'm sorry, but okay. So this is application of the Verant's rule with the model. The very simple application with these things that I shown before. So you can get this minimal length for equilibrium. And the idea is to compare that to the Verant rule, okay? For different values of some parameters. One of the parameters is how thick is the part of arch that is above the rim of the arch, okay? The H. And another parameter is the height of the pier, okay? So these are different heights of the pier, and this H is the height of the part that is above the arch. Okay, and you see that I tried with values that are what you see around, and this rule is always met very, very well. Okay, better than we will do today, where we apply coefficients of safety of 5, 6, or something like that. Okay. This was just to warm up. This is the case of the vaults. So as I told you, I can look at the vault, inside the vault. I can see inside it a membrane that carries a Dirac delta that is surface Dirac delta. This stress that is on the surface carries the imbalance of the stresses that go across the surface. Okay, what is the difference between a chain? Actually, the arch is a chain inverted. Okay, but This is an underdetermined system, and the membrane is not. It's statically determined. What is easy to see is that if you put the unilateral constraint, in a sense, this membrane becomes under constraint. You have to change the shape in some places in order that it gives you a shape that is compressive and inside the extra dos and intra dos of the. So unilaterally renders the membrane similar to the to a cord, to a wire, to a chain. Since you have to play with the shape of the surface, the better description is to use the Monge description. Here just some differential things with this curvilinear system, and this is the stress tangent to the vault. You can have to the membrane. I mean, you can have horizontal and vertical forces, and then this is standard because you can project this equation on the plant form. And this is the Pucker form of these equations. But what is nice is that for the projected part of the equations, you have the same form as in 2D. And if the horizontal force is zero, you can use the Eristres function, I mean the stress potential. And since the constraint is on the stress on the surface, and your variable is the pseudo-stress, you wish to know which are the consequences of the restrictions of unilaterally on the projected stresses. And what you find out is that, let me see, okay, okay, it's here, it is the same. I mean, what you get is that F must be concave. So it's exactly the same as projected stresses are different, conditions on them are a little different, but at the end, the condition is that F must be concave. As if there was something before. Yes, it was just a comment on the fact that you have to play with these two functions. One function is the stress potential, the other one is the shape. You can play on that to get the result you want, I mean, to get the surface inside the two extra dos and intra dos surfaces and get compression. Okay. Maybe I did something stupid. Okay, sorry. Okay. Some examples. Some of them would be useful also for tonight, I hope. The first one is very simple. It's a Volta Vela, it's called. That is a parabolic shape. And for that, you can use essentially a shape and a stress potential that are of the same form, let's say. Okay? So we go to the next one, next example. Next example is a case in which you can put a line Dirac delta in the stress function, that is, stress function have a fold. If you put a fold on the stress function, we have to have a fold on the surface, because otherwise you get a force that you don't have. You have just forces that are orthogonal to that. My is working, okay? I think so. So here there are two examples, a cross vault, Volta Crociera. There are some around, not here. Here, this classical. Okay, this one. And the other one is a cloister vault. Cloister vault is more usual in palazzi. For example, Palazzo della Signoria in Firenze, there are beautiful cloister vaults by Vasari, very large, 10 meters, 12 meters. Just with bricks this thick, impressive, okay? Okay, so this is a case of singular stress for the cross vault. Here I assume the stress and I look for the shape. Or you can do the inverse. And that's what you get. This is the stress, and this is the shape. Okay? They are in equilibrium. Everything is compressive. It's okay. So for the cluster you want to switch, you can't, because this is not concave. So this is this picture you see is just the volta that I told you of Vasari in Firenze. These are the feet of Massimiliano Lucchesi. And this is the thickness of the vault. And this is the view of the vault in the Reni, the part that is close to the walls, that has this kind of things that go against the vault. Okay. So here you try, but you can do anything. So you try again, you get a very weird shape. What you can do? You can assume, for example, that the stress surface is parabolic in a piece inside, and then you go with the uniaxial stress. So you create this kind of stress potential, and then you compute what the shape is. Okay? And this shape is much more closer to the cloister vault, this inside. Okay? Okay, here are domes. I don't want to superimpose to Gian Pietro, so I won't tell much. Only here there is an example of what happens when you put a lantern, it's called, I don't know, the lanterna, on a dome. This would give an effect of having traction somewhere that you have to correct. And this is maybe seen here. This is the stress function. When the stress function becomes concave, you have to stop. And there you have to put uniaxial stress. So you'll see there you will see fractures. Sometimes they show up in these thin domes when there is a very heavy lantern. Okay, this is a Pantheon. Okay, and let's see where is it. Okay, it is a long story. Okay, Control L. Okay, can you see anything? No, I'll go Teatro dell'Arte. Okay, this is the elastic model. I want just to stress a few things about this model. We can skip this part. And here there are the material restrictions for an elastic notation model. Yes. Okay. Okay. No. Okay, throw too much. Adatta larghezza. Okay. When you are here, you look like very stupid, okay? I'm not. Okay, so the first one is the assumption that the material is unilateral, that is there is no traction. The second one is the decomposition that is additive because there is an assumption of small deformations. The third one is the fact that material is elastic, linearly elastic. And the last two are the normality assumptions. These are the equilibrium equations, boundary conditions. Yes, here just one comment on the fact that when you assume that there is normality of the anelastic strain, there is a price to pay, that is that any fracture can open up only orthogonally to the surface. You cannot have slide or normal jump and slide, only normal jump. This is a very heavy assumption, okay? It's a kind of reminiscence of the cohesion of the material, okay? It's what happened at the beginning. When you open a crack, after it opened, it can slide. But at the beginning, maybe it's like that. And here is how the strain energy looks like in the 2D case when you assume isotropy. There would be something to say about the fact that the material is not isotropic, because you know that a wall is constructed in such a way that there are layers, and this large put a strong anisotropy, but it's very difficult to assess the anisotropy. Why? Because often you see what is outside the wall, but you never know what is inside. It's very different. The faces are very clean. You see something that is very nice. Inside you don't know what there is. So it's difficult to use the models that are not isotropic. So this is the surface. You see that there is this flat part. And with that you can use minimization of energy. I mean, you can look for the solution by minimizing an energy. And what you find, we find that is very convenient, is to look for this minimum just by descent. It's the more easy and straightforward way to get the solution. If I have time, I will show you some examples that are good in this sense. And I jump this part, okay. Let's go to one thing that could be of some interest. There are examples of non-existence, okay? I put two examples of non-existence. I think that this is a message that this material is a little delicate. You cannot put very concentrated force, you cannot change abruptly the load. And this is something that you find in the reality. I mean that the mesory suffers from loads that are concentrated. They try to, for example, they avoid to put straight architrave, no? What is the name of the architrave? I don't know. Okay, a straight bar on an opening. It's better to put an arch, okay? So this fact that mathematically you don't have a solution, it's not so surprising. You have to be careful with the loads, and you have to admit that you put the load in the way that you have a solution. Okay. Here there is a kind of a list of exact solutions. This is very trivial. I jump this. This is trivial, but I have to look at this because I will show you some numerical results where we try to. This is a benchmark problem for minimization. Because the solution is elementary from the point of analytical point of view, but numerically it's difficult. Okay, so this is a flexure, just flexure, and the flexure is such that the body is divided into two parts. One part is compressed, and the other part is inert. This is the solution. In this case, we see the possibility of different solution, because the solution is unique in terms of stress, but is not unique in terms of strains and displacement. So you can have different solution for the same in some cases. So this is a different solution. The solution before was continuous. This here you see some discontinuities, and you can put these discontinuities also in other ways. And here there is an example, an experimental test on a material that is very weak in traction, where there is this kind of crack here, and maybe you don't see, but here there is this other crack, vertical crack, okay? And this is another example where, very trivial, that is a pile of unilateral material on a smooth foundation. The solution is uniaxial. Alarm clock, 5 minutes, 3 minutes, okay. So I'll jump to the conclusions, maybe, okay. Okay, okay. Okay. This is the solution of this problem, okay. So there is a fracture, vertical fracture on this part. I don't have time to explain why. There is this is rather simple. Actually, you have only one statically admissible stress, so you have the elastic part that you know, and you look for the inelastic part in such a way that they are compatible. And the only way is this one. Okay, so if I can, I'll show you some applications. Okay, this is the model 1 and model 2, numerical application. This is the things that we want to model. This I jump because it's just a generalization of the strength criterion in 2D that is the more standard one. Here there are some experimental tests that are from Page. Okay. Okay, stop it. Okay. So this is the energy that I showed before, that is in the elastic case. And here is playing out the numerical procedure works. You start from an initial point and you go by descent to the minimum. Here is the comparison with the exact solution that I showed before, with the two kind of solutions. Here what we get, you see that here you see a different solution in you see two fractures inclined. I don't know if you can see them. This is another possible solution. Okay. But the stress is sketched quite well, and this is the case of the pile. Here we use C0 elements, so there are no possible discontinuities. So this would be a little tricky to find a solution. Okay. This is another case. I want just to go to the last part that is on. These are application of the normal elastic notation material obtained by simple minimization by descent. Okay, these are kind of nice. You see the. Okay, this code was made by the two colleagues that I don't see here, but that made a lot of work on this. Okay. So you see also principal line of stress and so on. And I just want to show you some applications of this model. You prolongate this linearly, okay? And and then you use the technique that I said. We use an adjourned energy that we minimize at each step. So we divide the loading process into steps. At each step, we minimize an energy that is changed. And this is the solution of the case where there is a limit strength. So I don't know if you see much, but there is a comparison between stress, real stress, and also the experiment. And here is another case, a case of simple shearing. The wall is fixed at the base on top, and you shear. And at the beginning, you see this race, and this is a solution that is kind of known. But when you go ahead, this changes. You see that they align, and then you create this band. Okay. And this is the plastic part that allows you to shear on a horizontal line. So in the end, you see, I don't know if you see much, but there is an experiment of on a wall in which you see that kind of collapse mechanism. These are fractures of detachment, and here you see the sliding. Okay, this is an example of a wall where there is an opening. What happens? I don't have the time to show it. Okay, I will stop here. I don't want to be too long. Okay, thank you.